Thank you very much for the invitation. The first time I was introduced to this certain field, even until the last lecture, around 2002, the field was in chronobiology, the study of our internal clocks. Until the very last moment, I thought, like, this is alien science, right? I got used to it over the years. So today, I would like to convince you that you have an internal clock. In fact, you have many clocks, and try to show you their function and what they do, and what happens when we disrupt them, in particular modern type of society or modern life, how they disrupted in our clock and what are the consequences of that. Okay. So, since dawn of life, or whenever we evolved, we were fascinated by time. You can see it in the water clock ancient Egyptians used. 14th century, we created the first mechanical clock, ended and so on. This hadn't evolved until nowadays, where we have at least cell phones to tell time, which is a very big mistake. And this didn't make sense because we were born into a world that is rhythmic. Due to the Earth's rotation about its axis. We got morning, noon, afternoon, evening, sun disappears, the night starts, that's where we sleep, temperature cycles throughout the day, the birds start singing in the morning, right, and then there's later in the day, and then it disappears, and during the night it becomes quiet, and at nighttime, and the nocturnal animals, of which there's many of them, existed in Australia particularly. So, life had evolved under these certain conditions, right? And that triggered formation of a clock from an evolutionary perspective. You have to imagine that very long time ago, there was no ozone layer, right? That means when you were exposed or were you exposed to sunlight, you basically were microwaved. So from an evolutionary perspective, to get away from this certain harm was to have a time, a mechanism to be able to foretell when events didn't happen in our surrounding environment. And that is what's believed, how it is believed that the evolution of a timing mechanism came about. Right? That allows you to predict when sun rises, so that whatever living being was there at the very early time, they can say, now the sun is rising, let me go and take it and cover. Right? And they take cover, disappear, and then come out at night again. But are we rhythmic too? How do we perceive time? What special senses are involved to perceive time or information from the environment? Do we have a clock? And if we have a clock, what type of clock do we have? So, the clock can be divided into three components: an input, an oscillator, and an output. And that was a very simplified schematic that was introduced by my PhD supervisor Arnold Eskin, who fortunately passed away during the pandemic, and he suffered from Parkinson's disease. And he left us with this central dogma in chronobiology called the Eskinogram. The input is very important. That could be light from the retina. And that is then communicated to an oscillator. It's something that oscillates and aligns our daily rhythms to geophysical time. And an output. An output could be metabolism, could be activity, sleep, etc. So how does this clock look like in us that is ticking? And it is literally ticking. And I'm going to prove it to you in a minute. In a very simple term, it consists of a positive element and a negative element that continued and interacted with each other. And they had an interaction happen over 24 hours to create a cycle. So something rhythmic happens. And in more complex terms, this is how it looks like. I'm not going to walk you through, just want you to look at this. This is how, the, again, simplified form, the clock looks like. It's called a molecular clock. This is how it looks like in rodents, right? So you have negative components, positive components, and they interact. Going to the fruit fly, looks very similar. There's positive components, negative components, and they interact. So there's just maybe the naming and the proteins look a little bit different. You go to a plant, similar thing, similar mechanism. The point I'm trying to make is that this molecular clock is conserved among throughout different phylogenies. The first certain experiment to be done to prove that there is a clock came from a French scientist. He was a physician, actually. He put a mimosa plant into a cupboard, which means he separated it from the surrounding day-night cycle, so they were not exposed to sunrise and sunset. And this mimosa plant, during the daytime, usually gets this, shows this type of the leaves, the position of the leaves, and during the nighttime it takes this conformation. And when he put that into a cupboard and closed it, and he came during the daytime and opened it, he found it and the plant showed this type of structure. And when he opened during the nighttime, it looked like that. So the plant continued to cycle, which was an early proof that there is a clock inside of these plants that drives physiology, in this case, the position of the leaves. You can try this at home as well. What about us humans? We had a person that went into the French Alps, locked himself in there for 62 days. Somebody monitored its sleep and wake and cycle. And you can see in this certain person over the 62 days that a person had an activity profile, which is marked here in dark blue, and then a sleep, which follows the activity, of course. And every day the person woke up a little bit later, right, than before. And that is because our internal clock is not ticking exactly 24 hours, it is a little bit more than 24 hours. What does that mean? That we are slowly shifting and getting out of sync with our geophysical time, which is determined by sunrise and sunset. Unless you have an input, which is the input we talked about, the schematic, the eschinogram, which is light. And what light does is it resets your clock every morning so that you maintain it and align it to sunrise with your activity. And that is shown in here very beautifully. If you take away light-dark cycles, constant darkness or constant light, you can shift a little bit every day. But when you can then return and exposed to sun presence and absence of sun, you maintain an aligned sleep and wake and cycle, like you, in the moment. Kids, first 6 months after birth, they do have a clock, but it's not ticking like it is with us. Their clock is very repeats itself in higher frequency, every 3 to 4 hours. Right? So for mothers to be, take this message at home, it's not the fault of the kid. It's just part of the development. Right? It takes time for that clock to develop. And this is how it looks like early on. And then it slowly consolidates, and then the nights become longer, or their sleep episode becomes longer until they show this schematic right here. So where is this clock sitting? There is a master clock that sits in your brain. It's called in the hypothalamus. And the hypothalamus is actually an area in the brain that is not more, or is the size of approximately an almond. It's very small. And the clock resides within a nucleus in that almond called the suprachiasmatic nucleus. And it is the smallest of the nucleus within that hypothalamus. And you can't even probably see it from the back because it's so small and it's in this certain area here. If I enlarge it and give you, for example, I can't really show you it in human, but I can do that in mice. And I show you the same at master clock. And this is how it looks like in mouse. It pulsates. These are neuronal firings. Every pulse is approximately takes 24 hours to complete. And this is what is going on in your brain as well. And this is what is telling you time. And telling your other brain cells what is time, and telling your periphery also what is time. It's called the master clock. So the master clock, how you can imagine it, it's like the conductor in the symphony. The conductor gives the instructions to the people, the musicians in there. Everybody is playing a melody, and based on the instruction that he provides, you get a symphony. Right? This is the function of your master clock. Now, not only is there a clock in your brain, you have a clock in virtually every organ and tissue in your body. Let's make it more problematic, complicated, in every cell in your body. There is an oscillator. And it regulates. There's a clock that is in the pancreas that regulates the function of your pancreas, a clock in your heart, in the gastrointestinal system, in your muscles, so it plays a role in exercise, in your fat and tissue, in liver, and in adrenals, etc. That means you have an orchestra in every organ, really, and tissue. Right? Now, can you imagine the complexity to get one symphony from many orchestras out? Very complicated system. Now, when you take away your master clock, or you take away the clock, it's like turning off the light. The musicians can't see the conductor, so the instructions are lost. And what happens is chaos. Chrono disruption. And this is what modern lifestyle is doing to us. And that's why rise of so many diseases and syndromes and like you have were introduced today, they are on the rise. Right? We are literally a sleep and deprived and chrono disrupted in society. Now, you can also disrupt your clocks in a different way. Now we said there's a clock and there's input, right? Or oscillator and there's input. The input, most strongest, is light. Can you imagine now why I said it and why the cell phone is a bad idea? Because it's light and the body responds very strongly to light. But it does also to food. So food is a time cue. The time at which you eat matters because it has an influence on your gastrointestinal system or in your feeding. And all that related to metabolism. So if you're working at nighttime, you're eating at nighttime, you're shifting your clock. And then you get conflicting inputs. So you have two conductors now that try to regulate the same orchestra and giving different instructions, and that causes certain chaos. The best way or example is in shift work. In shift work, particular rotating shift work, you work during the nighttime when the light is on, your body wants to sleep, your master clock wants you to sleep and facilitates everything for you to sleep, but you have no choice, you need to work. You eat during that time. The food is a time cue that tells you, no, you need to be active, you need to eat now, hunger and so on, right? But your metabolism is not made at that time or suitable. The conditions are not suitable to digest the food and equally well than it. And for example, you eat the food during the daytime, which causes then issues. So what does your clock regulate? Literally everything. Right? So alertness, there's a time where you're maximally alert, best body or musculoskeletal coordination, fastest reaction time, so there's a time for that. Cardiovascular efficiency and muscle strength and sleep, wake, and so on, blood pressure and so on. Hormones. Because there was also talk surrounding the metabolism, just bring up this here, that the liver, pancreas, fat, and muscle do different things when we are asleep and when we are active. Their function changes. For example, the liver during the daytime is involved in glycogen synthesis, but during the nighttime, it's opposite. Right? it's involved in glycogenolysis, which is the breakdown of glycogen, and so forth. Right? So the function of these different tissues varies depending on the time of the day. Now, one of the things that the clock regulates is sleep. In fact, you can't talk about sleep without talking and knowing the circadian system. That's why I had to talk and give you that short or rather long introduction about the clock. These are two systems that are so strongly intertwined you can't separate them. And that is, so you have your clock here, you have your sleep-wake circuitry. You imagine the cells in your brain distributed in different areas, and they interact and they cause a balance when you're awake and when you should also be sleeping. And they're influenced by the clock. They're influenced by your social clock. That could be your alarm clock, but also by homeostatic process, which is called process S. I'll go through this in a second. So what is sleep? The two definitions, or the primary definition that I like a lot, is from Flanagan et al., 1973. And he said, it's a behavioral state of quiescence distinguished from rest by an elevated arousal threshold and from torpor, hibernation, and death by rapid reversibility. This was picked up again later by Tobler in 2011. He also mentioned something about the difference between sleep and rest. Now, why I'm telling you this here is because of these smartwatches or devices that industry wants you to buy. And they're advertised as, yes, you can measure sleep and tells you how good you're sleeping and so on. I have to admit, smartwatches are getting smarter, but they're not there yet. Right? So sleep in general, so here in humans, difference in mice, of course, it consists of stages, right? So you have to go through three different stages of sleep. So you have in general two types of non-REM, a non-rapid eye movement sleep, and REM sleep, rapid eye movement sleep. And that's usually where the dreaming happens, and it's quite a short period. And these are measured by an EEG, and brainwave measurements, and based on the characteristics of these brain, you can determine what stage of sleep the person is in. A watch will never tell you or give you that information, that period, so don't fall for it. However, they're getting better, especially those watches or devices that take into account the heart rate, because at different stages of the sleep, your heart is a little bit different on how it's beating. And that into account with inactivity, rest, right here, comes quite close to telling you if you're in sleep, in very deep sleep or in light sleep. Now, just to show you the interaction between the sleep or the hourglass, the homeostatic sleep, and the circadian system. The hourglass up or the homeostatic sleep that is here in or static sleep pressure that is here in yellow, and that is the circadian drive. Okay, the circadian signal, the clock is the signal that the clock is coming from the clock is telling you be awake, right? It's wake stimulating. And then you have this during the wake time, which is in the early morning until in the evening, and you have this strong signal that goes in that direction. During this time, you have an increase with sleep need. Of course, the longer you are awake, more sleep desire. You get tired over time and you need to get more sleep, or you want sleep, until the balance is tipped and then you fall asleep, right? And that is also where the circadian clock is falling back its signal and strength. And then the homeostatic process or the sleep drive takes over. So it's attack and war between the wake-promoting signal and the sleep-promoting signal. Now I bring into this picture and make it a bit more complicated and add on top of the melatonin profile. Melatonin is a hormone that's secreted by the pineal gland and is also in your brain, and that usually only is up during the nighttime. It's a hormone and regulated by the clock, but also by light. And this melatonin, the present, is also believed, it's a theory, not proven yet, to have a play in that tug and war, to favor, because it comes later in the evening, and now it favors and stands on the side of it in the sleep promoting signal, and then it is believed to tip that balance it over. I just want to show you an experiment we have done to prove that the clock is indeed involved in shaping your sleep-wake cycle. And here we have lesioned this small nucleus that you have seen. We put an electrode in the brain of a mouse, applied an electric current, lesioned this, and the mouse went from this organized sleep-wake rhythm into this very disorganized sleep-wake cycle. So the mouse wakes up every 5 minutes or so. So what the clock does, it consolidates your sleep to one part of your 24-hour day and the activity to the other part of it. How much sleep do you need? Dying question. Depends on your age and depends on many other factors as well. So the younger you are, the more sleep is required. And as you age, that amount of sleep decreases. But it is a range, right? So it decreases with age. But I don't want you now to get away with it and say, oh, I'm not getting my 8 hours of sleep, or I have a problem. Because then you are under stress, and then you have to see an expert. We are all very different, and also very different in what we do during the day. If you are happy, right, and you feel comfortable, and even if you just get 4 hours of sleep, well, I'm not going to exact, but you get less than what is on the chart, you're doing fine with your sleep. That's all I want to say. If you want to decide how much sleep you need, you can ask yourself these certain questions. I don't want to go through it. It's long because of time, but I'm happy to forward the slide to you. Just very quickly, maybe. Are you productive, healthy, happy on only 7 hours? If the chart says 9, if you're happy with that, then you're fine. Right? Do you have a health issue? Right. Then you need to reevaluate it and how much whether you go back to what is recommended or not, and so forth. So there are certain questions here you can ask yourself or decide whether the amount of sleep that you're getting is adequate for your lifestyle and your health situation. Now, sleep has a very different function. Again, it depends on what age. Very early on, sleep helps build the brain's infrastructure. But later on, it switches to become more of a decluttering role. And this actually is a study that was published in 2020, so last year, where the researchers showed for the first time that, and this is in humans, that this switch between it and the brain, building brain infrastructure and the decluttering happens for unknown reasons yet at the age of 2 years. Having said that, the point I want to make is maybe to take home when you talk to younger individuals of your family or friends, it is an investment now for your future, right? Sleep hygiene and getting that sleep is an investment. What does sleep deprivation do, or not getting enough sleep? Many academics that I've talked to, they come and they bolster and say, I'm getting 5 hours of sleep, I'm robust, right? I don't know if it has something to do with masculinity or not, but they feel like it's something, right? You may not feel it now, but it will have the consequences later on. This study has shown it in humans. One night of sleep deprivation in an adult causes a significant increase in two components, tau and alpha-synuclein. Tau and tauopathy, which is related to Alzheimer disease, and alpha-synuclein, synucleinopathy, which is linked to Parkinson's disease. one night of sleep deprivation increases these amounts significantly, which means it's similar. I didn't want to use this analogy, but I'm going to do it anyway. Some people are currently with the AstraZeneca vaccine are scared or think it is a lottery, right? Although the chances that you're getting a blood clot is very, very, very low, but it's still a lottery. Now, can you imagine one sleep deprivation, which you are doing every day anyways, because we are really in a sleep deprived community or society globally, you're playing that lottery on a daily basis. Improve your sleep today, make sleep priority. It was touched, I'm not going to go through, it's the same at points, actually less, so you covered it, thank you. Light pollution. This is when I said modern lifestyle is, for me, a carcinogenic. Light is equivalent to how it is currently applied and used, it's equivalent to a carcinogen. This is how much light you're exposed to when you live in the city. This is how the sky looks like if you can look up. You don't see much stars. This is if you go to the countryside. And this causes certain huge problems. Here's a mouse brain. Here is your master clock. You don't see anything there. It's quiet during the nighttime. You go to the bathroom. You turn on the light. In seconds, this is what you do to your brain. You light it up. You stimulate it. You stimulate your clock. The more you're exposed to that light during the nighttime, the worse you're going to feel next day because you're jet-lagging your clock. You're shifting your internal clock. That's why you feel it so bad the next day. Not from a single session going to the bathroom, but if you do it for over a longer period of time or expose yourself to light for a longer period of time. And then you see these things on the internet, people try to sell you, and that really upsets me. Because they're turning on the light. Now, remember the melatonin and the tug of war, that the melatonin is there when there is during our sleep time, and that it is that extra hand that may be on the side of the sleep promotion part of the balance? Well, melatonin is regulated by the clock, that is true, but it is also sensitive to light. If you can turn on the light, there is a very, very, very fast drop of your endogenous melatonin levels. So when you go to the restroom, there's an interruption in your melatonin secretion during the nighttime. So looking at the watch or being up late night suppresses your melatonin, and that's not good for your sleep. Just very quickly, body temperature, it was touched as well upon. Body temperature minimum is when you have the high propensity for sleep. So you need to sleep in an environment or in a room that has is relatively cool and comfortable, so you can create it in this certain profile. This is a shift worker. Consolidated sleep, because it sleeps during the time where it's supposed to be, and this is sleep, fragmented sleep, because it needs sleeping at a time when the clock is telling you to wake up. Your body wants to wake up, but the hourglass clock that you turned it around is telling your body you want to sleep, right? So you never get the sleep quality that you need. Chronotypes and sleep problems. You have heard the terminology larks and owls. So larks are those certain individuals are very early people. You go to bed early, 7 or so, and you wake up maybe 2, 3, maybe 4 in the morning. And the owls, they can go to bed at very late, 12, 1, 2 like myself, and then I have to get up at 8 for work. Very problematic. The only good thing is, apparently, is that the owls seem to be smarter, but live less because of the stress. We don't get the sleep. We are exposing ourselves to the stress every day. We have to wake up at 8 o'clock. Our body doesn't want to wake up at 8 o'clock, right? We wake up on the alarm clock every day.
that is stress, we are severely sleep deprived. Now, there's two type of syndromes that you may have caught through the media. One is called advanced sleep phase syndrome, the other delayed sleep phase syndrome. The advanced sleep phase syndrome is usually linked to the early risers, the early people, and the delayed sleep phase syndrome to the latent or the owls. Now, when you hear that, there's nothing wrong with you, let me tell you. If you're an early riser, your sleep is absolutely fine. If you're a latent riser and late person, your sleep is absolutely fine. It is your interaction with the society and your work schedule that causes these issues, right? This is the problem, right? It's not being early riser or late riser, etc. So just bear this in mind. So now you ask your question, okay, then if we have this sleep problem, we are sleep deprived and so on, and we have these disorders, so what can we do about it, right? Can we take melatonin? Yes, you can. Can adjust your clock very efficiently. Melatonin also is a soporific, has a soporific effect which aids you to go to sleep. So it has sleep promoting effects. But you have to time it very properly and the dosage needs to be correct. What we are doing here, we're introducing it in something called it in chronotherapy. We're trying it with the fundamental understanding of these clock and what is involved and its components and where it is sitting. We're trying to tap it into these certain clock. If you have a mouse, or if you had it, if your clock is not, your master clock is not working properly, remember you have other clocks in your body you could utilize to make up for the loss of that clock. I'll give you an example. If you lesion your master clock here, and in this case it's a mouse, and just using Pavlovian conditioning, do you remember the dog, meat, the bell, the dog and the meat, yeah, and the salivation? We use the same thing, but different stimulus that we know can tap into the limbic system, mesolimbic system here. So when we combined a running wheel, which is a treadmill, with methamphetamine, please don't take methamphetamine. We just want to make a point. When we combined these two together, we were able to harvest the clock that is located in another part of the brain, which is in the nucleus accumbens. And that clock was strong enough and sufficiently connected to other parts of that body that it could reinitiate the sleep and wake and cycle. And I'm not telling you something witchcraft. This is the mouse that was lesioned. It's completely arrhythmic. There's no pattern there. This is during the time where we introduced a running wheel, paired it with it and injections, methamphetamine. And then we removed the methamphetamine, just gave him the running wheel, that means just ringing the bell, right? And then he had a locomotor activity or sleep-wake rhythm was introduced. Thank you for your attention.